And we're live.
Hey, how's it going, buddy?
Hey, man. How you doing?
Tired.
Understandable. My invention's killing you.
No, we went out to Area 51 last night and like got lost in the desert and like it was crazy. Like we drove like 500 miles and but it was awesome. Peter did this awesome effect out there. And I don't want to run it, but I'm sorry. I've had like 30 minutes sleep.
You're all good.
He's gonna be posting it soon, but it's awesome. Like he hypnotized a guy out there in the middle of Area 51, and it was like the dude was about to cry. It was awesome.
Oh man! And he said he's gonna be posting up a video about that.
There will be a video of it. Yeah. I don't know when he's going to post it, but yeah, there's going to be a video of it.
Awesome, man. All right. Well, welcome everyone to another Believe in Magic Place Q&A. I'm going to be your host, Alex Borton. We have today the great and powerful Morgan Strebler. Yay, Morgan.
Woo! I feel like I'm part of the Wizard of Oz or something.
While we're ramping up viewers and getting started, for people who don't know you who are logging in, you want to give everyone a quick little bio of who you are, what you do?
Yeah, sure. I grew up in a small town in Missouri called Sykeston, and I started magic when I was a kid after seeing Harry Blackstone Jr. Perform Pete's modeling for me in his underwear. I seen Harry Blackstone Jr. at a show, and I pretty much knew that's what I wanted to do when I got older was magic. And then a couple years later, I seen David Copperfield live at Caesar's Palace in Las Vegas, and yeah, that was pretty much sold the deal for me.
Yeah.
And I got a female mentor who helped me with the presentation side of things, and she had like a whole bunch of magic and stuff, and she gave me like unlimited resources to like her library and things like that and props. And then as I got older, I got another mentor. I moved to Las Vegas, and Franz Ferrari became my mentor. I've been an illusionist for years. Always been an illusionist and a mentalist, but Franz Ferrari became my mentor, and I would go places and do like Franz's show when Franz couldn't do it and stuff like that. And he really helped me out with illusions and basically poured like 40 years of knowledge into me. So I mean, it's pretty amazing. I was really blessed. And then now I consider I've been doing mentalism for years. I consider Peter to pretty much be my mentor in mentalism. You want to say hi, Pete? Hold on. Peter's going to say hi to everyone.
Maybe Isaac just got off the show. Up, so
hey there, Pete.
How are you? Alright?
I'm doing alright. You guys look pretty tired.
It's crazy, yeah. We drove about 400 miles. I went to the middle of the desert yesterday. I went to Area 51. We didn't sleep. We had slept for 2 or 3 days. So I was sure this afternoon. I mean, some executives this morning. So please don't think we're rude. I'll let you get on, so I don't want to rush on this. But
tune in, guys.
Right. It's going to be awesome.
That's great, man. Well, you know, we'll try not to keep you guys around too long, let you guys get some sleep. We got questions pouring in, though. We got questions coming in left and right.
Cool.
Let's start out with Sam Pandya. He says, I'm going to start learning metal bending now. How do I get started? How do I develop my skills for metal bending?
Okay, there's many, many resources on metal bending out there, and you got to find out what kind of style suits you and what kind of metal bending you want to do. First of all, you have Ben Harris's book, which is great. It's called Gullerism Revealed. You have Banachek, Psychokinetic Civil War. You got Guy Bavely's videos. You have Patrick Cuffs. You have I have a couple of DVDs out as well. And same with D. Christopher. There's a lot of resources on it. And the thing is I would actually, I think Gallerism Revealed by Ben Harris should be in every Metal Bender's library. It's a wonderful, wonderful book. And to get started, like the best forks that you can get right now on the market are from wizardmagic.co.uk, or I mean wizardmagic.com, excuse me. They're called Liquid Forks. And they're absolutely great for metal bending and stuff like that. And I highly recommend those because those are the ones that I use. And, I mean, they're really, really good. And they're great for beginners. But they're also great when you have to bend metal, like, all night long or something, you know. And they're great for, like, the problem areas that you're going to have with, like, quirk screws and stuff like that.
All right. Absolutely. And, how about for muscle? Any specific muscle exercises? I know I work. I'll take and find stronger forks and just do straight bends, just as a practice exercise to kind of get certain fingers a little bit stronger, make things a little easier.
Well, the more Civil War you bend, obviously, the higher grade of Civil War you can bend. I can pretty much, after bending 60,000 forks, I can pretty much bend any kind of Civil War. So, I mean, it's not really, I mean, you get used to it. It's just something, it's like a deck of cards or anything else. You just have to put a lot of time into it. But, and a lot of metal bending, even though some Civil War is harder, like the stuff like the corkscrew, stuff like that, that's technique versus strength. You know, and the there's a lot of misdirection in it too. I mean, it's I would watch. I mean, the thing is there's a lot of different factors that go into it. I mean, you have your traditional metal bending, where you put a bend in a spoon or a fork, and then they go off and they grab another one. It takes them like, you know, several minutes to bend it or whatever, and they go to another spoon and they'll put another bend in or a fork and then so on and so forth. My theory was a little different. My theory is if you could actually bend metal, you would mutilate the fork. You wouldn't just put one little bend in it, and if you had this gift, it wouldn't take you 10 minutes to do it, you know?
Right.
It would be more like...
It would be within motion. It would be real right in front of you.
Yeah. And a lot of people say I took the magic approach or stuff like that, which is fine. I don't care because liquid metals, you know, pretty much made my career. And, I mean, I'm thankful for it. And, you know, I did it yesterday at Mindvention, and people, I mean, were still asking to see it. So, I mean, it's been out for – I've been doing liquid for 15 years. It's been on the market for 10, so.
Right. Actually, speaking of liquid metal, Stuart Palm asks, what kind of influence do you feel liquid metal has had on mentalism as a whole? And what would you do differently now if you could?
That's a two-part question. I don't really know what it's done for mentalism as a whole. There's so many great products out there. I can't really say that my products really define an art form or done anything for mentalism as a whole. I think us as creators, we each add elements and we do our little part in history. And, you know, with all the information out there, it makes you a better performer. And I think that the other question, what was it?
The rest of the question was, refreshed on me. The rest of the question was, would you do anything different now if you could, referring to
liquid metal, the original routine? No. I still do it exactly the same as I did. I've added some minor touches in here and there, but it has a nice flow to it. It has a beginning, a middle, and an end, and a nice souvenir. And it took me a long time to construct the routine, so I really wouldn't change it in any way. Mm-hmm. I just changed subtleties here and there and some wording and added a couple of just different bins, like the shadow bin, stuff like that. But it's I don't know, it's probably one of, it's in my opinion, it's the most perfect routine I've ever created. Because it has a flow of beginning, middle, end, and it builds in the right places, and I just got lucky, I think.
Well, success is part luck. But you know what? I've always believed you build your own luck. You know, hard work pays off eventually. You know, you can't get lucky one time if you haven't tried a million times. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. You know what? The thing is in this business, if you if you can't take no, I mean, you're going to hear it hundreds of, not thousands of times in your career. If you can't take here a no, you're in the wrong business, because you're going to hear it a lot. And you got to get thick skin as a performer, because, I mean, it's you have to just have really thick skin, because there's a lot of people in this industry who look out for them. And I'm not saying magicians in general, but you have to, the sharks out there, like the agents and the managers and the stuff like that, and they'll just completely take advantage of someone coming into the business that doesn't know, like, the business side of magic. Because, you know, it is show business. It's not just show. So you really need to educate yourself with the business side so you don't get screwed over. I mean, I've been screwed over several times, and it's you know, you live and you learn, but I mean, it's better to learn before, you know, those things happen.
Right. And that's the, and some of that just comes with time. I've been personally of the idea, I actually come from a business background before I come from a magic background, because my father was a business owner before me. So something when I started into the magic realm, I noticed that a lot of magicians were great performers, and some of these guys were great, but as businessmen, it just... You know, they weren't smart businessmen.
Yeah, my father was a businessman too, and I know a lot about business. And I mean, it's very, I highly, everybody, you know, what book do you recommend? I recommend, like, you know, Maximum Entertainment. It teaches you some finer performing, you know, techniques and stuff like that for mentalism and stuff like that. But I also recommend getting books on business and learning business, especially the entertainment business. I mean, it's a rough and brutal industry, and I mean, people just, you know, everybody's out for their self.
Right. Well, I mean, it's kind of self-centered, you know, it's all about me. I'm out there, I'm on stage, it's about me, so it should be about me, you know what I'm saying?
Well, and you know what my whole theory is? My whole show is based around the audience. I don't, it's never look at what I can do, it's look at what you can do through me. So I'm like a mediator to my audience, if that makes sense to you. You know what I mean? And it's cool, because everybody likes to be the star of the show. And if you can make them the star of the show, they're going to like you a lot more. And that's the thing, you have to connect instantly with your audience, especially with stage. I mean, well, close up as well. I mean, if you don't connect in the first 30 seconds, you're going to lose them. And I mean, you have to learn how to connect with them.
Right. Absolutely. You know, that's a really common thing that comes up in Q&A is connecting with your audience. You have to be able to not just perform at them, but, like, include them within the performance in some way.
Well, and that's the biggest problem that a lot of performers starting off, and including myself, I did it at first, you talk at the audience instead of talking to them. And the thing is the more comfortable you get performing and doing stuff, I've done over 4,000 live shows, so, I mean, I'm a lot more comfortable now. And, you know, I'm just real with my audience, and, you know, it's like they're friends of mine, and I'm taking them on a journey, and we're going to have fun for the next 90 minutes and sit back and enjoy the ride. And, you know, you can't teach someone experience. And the best experience, or the best, like, advice that I ever got was go somewhere and be bad. Because you want to go somewhere and hone your skills. If your ambition is Vegas, if that's your end result, or Branson, or to have your own show somewhere, go somewhere and be bad. And if you go somewhere and be bad, you'll really get the time needed, and you'll really learn your show. You'll learn showmanship. You'll learn all the things that you need to learn as an up and coming, you know, magician, illusionist, mentalist, whatever. Just get out in the trenches and do it as much as possible. And, you know, that's the only way you're going to learn how to cover yourself, outs, stuff like that. And, you know, I highly recommend if you're into illusions, getting a dance class. You don't have to. I mean, the point is, if you can get from point A to point B and look good, that's all that matters. But, you know, take a jazz or a hip-hop class or something, and it'll help you out tremendously. You know, it's mentalism. Just learning stagecraft in general. I think if you're in college, you should be in theater classes. If you're in high school, get in theater classes. I really believe that learning just, you know, stagecraft is important in general because, you know, when you're doing cue sheets, music, lighting, sound, you know, you have to know all this stuff. And, I mean, you can't just learn it overnight. And you know, It's one of those things that's a process, and you live and you learn, but you can eliminate a lot of these areas by studying them on your own and, you know, just go somewhere, be bad, like I said.
Right. You learn so much more from failure than you do success. That's something I've been told my entire life, and I find it very, very evidently true.
Yeah, I fail daily, so, I mean, I must be learning a lot.
You know, I mean, it gets better. It could get worse, but I mean, you work hard, it gets better. So
yeah.
You mentioned including the audience as much as possible. And cold reading. I know you have a product, Ice Cold, that came out very recently.
Same plug.
Where are we going? Ice Cold. Yes. That's the one.
Yes.
Chris Whip asks, rather, how did you get your start with cold reading?
You know, I started doing cold reading probably about 10 years ago, and the thing that I liked about cold reading was I started using it to enhance my mentalism effects, and I would use it because you can take a little bit of cold reading and you can enhance anything in your repertoire just by, you know, because it builds a connection with the audience. And one of the biggest things about cold reading is you have to be sincere. Hold on, there's an alarm going off. All right, well, at least we got sound effects.
Ready?
Let me unplug this thing. I don't even know how to turn it off. What the heck?
It's the terrorists.
I don't use alarm clocks because I can't hear them, so I have to be physically woken up. Okay, this is annoying. I'm sorry. It's taking up most of the interview right here.
Okay.
Anybody have any suggestions on how to turn off a damn alarm?
Point the camera at it, I can tell you.
Hold on a second, let me figure this out.
You have a hammer. I got something. Use that, right there.
There. I unplugged it.
Okay, there we go.
Cut my arm in the process, but I got it. Sorry for the sound effects.
That's all right.
I had to show a little bit.
You were talking about how you got into cold reading.
Yeah, so I started off using it to enhance my effects and really just, you know, build an extra little rapport with the audience. And then I started falling in love with the readings as a whole, and I started learning oracles, whether it be palm reading, tarot, or runes, stuff like that, numerology. And I would apply... I came up with a system, and the system obviously is ice cold. And I actually, Ulysses made a bet with me. Because every time I go somewhere, the first thing I do is I read someone. I mean, I read probably 10 or 15 times daily, plus I do psychic fair, stuff like that. And it's really cool. I mean, the thing is it's one of those things, if you don't care about people and you don't genuinely want to treat them like a brother or a sister or a mother or father or something like that, it's the wrong thing to do for you. And you have to genuinely care. And you have to be very, very careful, because there's a thin line on what you can do. And my book's very dangerous in the wrong hands, because it's one of those systems that doesn't really miss. So in the wrong hands, it could be a bad thing. And, you know, but as long as you just have to learn how to, you have to learn how to conduct yourself, and you have to have empathy, and you have to show, like, that you sincerely care. And there's tons and tons of material on cold reading if you're interested to get started. It's actually pretty easy. I mean, you look like you were about to say something.
Oh, yeah. Actually, one of the questions that came up was Stuart Palm asked a simpler version, what is cold reading, for the people who don't know? So that was a great lead-in.
Okay. Well, let's see what cold reading is.
let's open it up.
It's funny Stuart should say that. The title and chapter.
What is cold reading? All right.
Before we begin, let's delve a little deeper into the fundamental principles of cold reading. Most people contend cold reading is a series of techniques used by mentalists, psychics, fortune tellers, and mediums to determine or express details about another person. This is normally done to convince the subject the reader knows much more than they actually do. Cold readers commonly employ high probability guesses about the subject, quickly picking up on signals from the subjects as to whether their guesses are in the right direction. Then the reader emphasizes and reinforces and change connections to the subject to knowledge while quickly moving on from misguesses. Although this is a good description of traditional cold reading, I have chosen as cold as the vehicle to explain how you can drastically expand the techniques and strategies of the art. You will then be able to forge unparalleled connections with your subjects at any times, any place, being in tune with your subjects at the highest possible levels that earns their trust and confidence. This is when the quote-unquote magic happens. You have broken down the barriers of your subject's mind. You are now on the inside. Now the information you need from the subject... I'm not going to sit here and read the book. That's very Andy Kaufman-like. But the point I'm getting at is, cold reading is essentially, if you want to be truly cold, you walk in, you know nothing about that person, and you're able to basically describe future, past, and... present traits about this person and stuff that there's no way that you could possibly know about them. Short answer. And every reading, I think, should be positive. I don't get into health. I'm not a doctor, so I don't get into health. I don't get into stuff like that. I try to stay away from, like, I don't talk to mediums. I don't talk to, you know, or I'm not a medium. I don't talk to the dead. Excuse me. You just, you know, there's boundaries. And cold reading is, you know, there's also, like, hot reading where you have information ahead of time and you can use that. I don't really use that. I like going in more of the cold approach, you know. It just suits me better, and I personally like it, you know, the better than, like, warm or hot reading.
Right, no, absolutely. Preston actually asks, because Ian, you almost touched on it there for a second. How is your cold reading system different from others?
Well, the thing that makes my system different from others is, and Laura, if she's listening, I actually read for her, and I think she's read part of the book. What makes my system different is I've come up with a way to where I use statistics in my readings, and I show you how to apply statistics in readings, as well as I have a way to where you don't miss. So, and I also give an oracle that teaches you how to, you know, like palm reading to runes and tarot, and teach you how to incorporate my system into one of these oracles, or you don't even need an oracle at all. But I prefer like palms. Palms is my favorite. And then you can, from there you can, I give you like an hour script to get you started. So it kind of just shows you like, it's a safety net. I don't want you to live off of the script and just go off that all the time and that be your thing. But, you know, if you ever get in a pickle on something and you know, it's there and you've got it memorized and you can throw it out and you've got lines in your arsenal. Peter Turner described, like, scripts and stock lines or whatever best. And he said it's like getting a different pair of shoes, you know? And it's really true. I mean, you know, everybody owns a bunch of pairs of shoes. You just put on a different pair of shoes for different situations, and you know, you're not going to go up and perform, you know, a mentalism show in flip flops.
Right.
So I mean, you have
to have different things you can say to different people. Different things work in different situations. What works?
Yeah,
right,
a lot of that is, and it's covered in the book as well. It's like body language. You look at people, you figure out, okay, how's this person dressed? How, you know, is their skin look? How do they look like they've lived a rough life, an easy life? I mean, and you know what I'm saying. And you size up the person, and you can generally tell by what they're wearing, how they carry themselves. It's really not as hard as people think it is. It's just scarier to get into because you're going out there with essentially nothing. And it's really scary at first for a lot of performers, I think, but the only way you're going to get good at cold reading is to actually go out and do it.
Right, and a lot of it's based on, I mean, like you said, you use lots of statistics. When I started cold reading, that's how I thought about it within my head was, you know, statistically high probability that this person, since she's 24 and is kind of like, hey, let's go party, it gets motherly, she's probably the oldest of so many children, which blah, 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 and that leads into, and I think that's like a birth order book or something I got that out of.
Well, and one of the biggest things that a lot of readers don't do, I mean, especially starting off is they don't listen. Best thing you can do if they start talking, listen. You know, because they're going to give you so much valuable information about yourself that you can turn around and, you know, reiterate it back to them in a different way, and they'll, you know, it'll sound like it came from you because they won't even realize. I mean, the best thing is when they start talking, just listen.
Right. Absolutely. So we were talking about presenting to different audiences. Poshak Dua asks, how do you work on your presentation and acting, and what's the best way for people just starting out? I know you said dance lessons and things like that, depending. What about for mentalists?
First thing you need to do is define your character and see who you want to be. I have a sort of characters, but my character is basically an extension of myself. It's just more alive. You know what I mean? It's I'm not reaching out for, you know, some mysterious blah blah blah. I mean, I look creepy enough with my eyes as it is. So it's an extension of myself, because you have to be who you are as a person, and they've got to see that through you, and you've got to shine some character. Now, I'm not saying you don't have a character and you don't have, you know, stuff like that, but I think character really needs to just be an extension of yourself.
Right.
And acting, you know, learning how to act is a good thing. If you can get in theater or drama, that's a good place to start. But the thing about mentalism is a lot of presentation, you know, that builds up to a climax. So, I mean, it's you know, there's big differences between magic, mental magic, and mentalism. And I don't think a lot of magicians can tell the difference between mental magic and mentalism. You know?
Yeah. Well, the way I always generally describe it is, like, I do a number prediction. I do five digit numbers. And the way that one ends up being achieved is I do something fancy in the back and some number work, and I give it out to them. That's mental magic. What's up?
It's cool, though.
Right. But that's mental magic, as opposed to mentalism tends to be less gimmicked, we'll say.
Yeah. Well, I can do basically a couple hours for at all. I can, like, borrow anything I need to do. Like, if I'm just out in the mountains and, like, do something, I can literally do 2 hours for nothing. I can do an hour reading, an hour and a half of just mind reading and stuff.
Right.
And it's not counting like Ben and Silverware. But, I mean, it's one of those things that you grow in. You know, I'll show you a great mentalism piece that is in Peter's new notes if you want to see it.
Sure.
We haven't prearranged anything or done anything like that, have we?
Oh, no.
Okay, I was just letting everybody know that you're not in or anything like that. That looked convincing. Now, I'm just kidding. Do you know your astrological sign? Like, for example, like Leo. Do you know what you are?
Yeah.
Okay, good. I want you to concentrate. I just want you to imagine the letters in front of you, okay? And I want you to concentrate on them, and I want you to send them to me. But with you maybe never turning information like this in this particular way before, we might run into a long way, but I think it'll be fine. The first thing I want to ask you, is there an R in yours?
Yes.
Okay. An A?
Yeah.
I'm a little... I'm not 100% sure on this one. The connection is kind of... There's a little bit of background noise. Is there an I in it?
Yes.
An S? An S?
No.
Okay. Now, what I want you to do is I just want you to picture your star sign. And I want you to picture spelling it out loud and tell me when you're done. You know what? Better yet, don't. I said, you know what? I just want you to imagine. Are you a Capricorn?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. Now, and then from there you can go into a reading or you could go into something like that. And he's got some really great stuff in there. I mean, like, this book is wonderful. These notes are great. There's a lot of great material in here.
And that was from Peter's new notes?
Yeah, yeah. When in Rome?
When in Rome, yes. that's not something I've been able to get my hands on, but that's no, that one was and you can do any star sign with that one real easy.
Yeah. It's awesome. And you can actually have I'm not gonna run it. There's some great effects in there. He's not here, so I'm not gonna talk about the book. But I mean, as soon as I read it, I put like five things in my show.
What, five of when in ropes? When in Rome?
Yeah, like literally into the five things. I put them into like walk, you know. They're strong. I mean, it's some of the best material I've seen in a long, long time. It's really top notch. I mean, Peter's a pioneer in the art, I think.
Absolutely, man. And he just keeps on putting stuff out left and right. It's
I don't see how he does it. He literally. I've spent, like, we don't really speak here, but he works constantly. Like, all he's doing is writing constantly when we're in the room. So, I mean, he's just full of ideas. I mean, he is, really.
Well, you know, I mean, that's the only way to pump out that sort of material, man. Laura Isley asks, do you have any new exciting projects actually coming out? We keep on hearing about them, but... we don't know when any dates are.
Five new products coming out. I'm flying to Vancouver on Wednesday. I'm shooting 2 or 3 DVDs, and I have a Magic app coming out and another product. But I can't give the definitive dates on them yet because I'm not sure myself. So it'll be, I know one of them will be out the first time, and then the others will be out next year.
Is there
any... And the app, yeah, before that. So the app will be out this year as well, too.
Oh, yeah. Is there any like sneak peeks you can give us for anything or mini performances?
Well, one of the deck of cards that I'm coming up with. So I can't really give a speech to that. The other is I'm putting out a co-reading DVD set, so it'll be a companion to the book, I guess.
Okay.
I'm really excited about that because the one thing the book is great in my opinion as a read. You can't see me out doing the readings. You know what I mean?
Right.
And I think it's good. I think it's valuable to see someone giving the actual readings and seeing what you take and comprehend and see it in action, you know?
Absolutely. I mean, there's only so much you can get from reading a book in theory. That was the one thing I loved about technical school was you have theory one day, lab the next. You know, you get to watch people do things, and then, like, if you can watch somebody fail... That's just as valuable as, or almost as valuable as, you know, watching it yourself and not having to go through that.
Here, I'll do something else. Let me find my notepad. All right, I got my notepad. I'm going to make a prediction. Pick two people out of the people listening to help out.
Okay. Stuart Palm and Scott Anderson.
Okay.
You guys will be helping out because I see you're posting. There we go, guys. I just turned down Morgan's speaker. Sorry, I had it up during the earlier reading. So, it's down now.
Hopefully you can read this. Can I just type it to you and you read it out?
If you'd like, there is a chat option here.
Where's it at?
I'm opening it now.
That way you can read it out and there's no funny business. My writing's messy. Okay, so I just click on this.
You should just be able to type in there.
Okay. Letting me. Oh, I see it. I'm on a PC. I don't use PCs. I use Macs.
Ah. Yeah.
Let's see what people are saying.
We're not sure yet, Stuart. Let's see here. Scott.
Who else is Scott?
Scott Anderson, but I didn't see him repost. I might have Christopher Thies.
We'll use Christopher.
Okay, so Stuart and Christopher.
Almost ready. Not writing a new book. Now, I sent a prediction to you. You can read it. What I want to do is it involves a little bit of suggestion, a little bit of intuition, and just a little bit of fate, okay? I want Stuart to imagine he's going to start off. We have three objects, keys, coin, and a pen. Or let's make it a wallet, okay? Keys, coin, and a wallet. And so with these items, I want him to just cycle them through his mind, okay? Just cycle them through his mind over and over and over and stop it but one, but don't say anything of what it is. Is he ready?
There's a time delay between live and him, so we'll have to wait a second to see what he's going to do. So is he supposed to guess, tell you?
He's just supposed to cycle through and pick one, but I don't want him to say which one just yet.
Okay, so I'm sure he's doing that. He's probably about 30 seconds behind us, so.
Okay, no problem.
Let's see. Would you like him to tell us when he's done?
Just tell me when he's done, yeah.
All right, he's imagining.
All right, and when he's done with that, what I want him to do is if he could, I want him to change it. What would the next choice be if you were to change it again?
All right. He said ready. Let's wait a second longer. Let's see here. There we go. All right, so do you want him to say what he picked now?
Yeah, his mind. I want him to name that object out loud.
Okay, so name your object then, Stuart. Wait for that to come through real quick. It's the NSA. They have to monitor us.
Oh, okay.
Is that Pete coming through?
Yeah. I thought you left already. I had to rip the alarm off. I couldn't turn it off. Oh, I didn't see that. It is a big ass button. I don't use alarm clocks, so.
All right, he says keys.
Okay, now I want him to think of the original object and name it out loud as well.
Okay. Alrighty. I'll let you know when that comes up.
This takes way too long.
Unfortunately, yeah, because they're not live with us. This would have helped if I had two people here in my office.
Yeah. You want to just... Did they answer? All right, let's just scratch this effect and get back to the interview.
Okay, let's scratch that. We'll do it again next time. Something with more people. Hey, Pete. How you doing?
We really couldn't understand. And the people here just don't understand what you're telling them. So Morgan went up to this lady at the convention desk and told her his name several times. And she's like, I don't get it. So he's silent for a while. And this is how she ended up spelling it. Still got it on her face. Told her several times.
Tell them about your wake up call, your daily wake up call.
So, I'm going to give anybody a piece of advice if you ever come to a convention and Morgan's at it and you end up staying in the same room. I often see, people know me, you know, me know that I follow. I got to sleep, and I sleep 1-2 hours a night, and that's it. But for the most part, there's some nights I don't sleep at all. So today we've had 2 hours sleep. That's it. So that's what we've got today. And I said to Morgan, do not wake me up at 5 o'clock, Morgan. Morgan has a tendency to Skype me at 5 o'clock in the morning and call me every single day, 5 times a day in the morning. He's done so for the last year. So I'm in bed. I get off to sleep at about 4 o'clock, and it's a comfy sleep. I've had very long in 7 hours, not slept for 2 days. And I strategically asked Morgan to wake me up at 5 o'clock in the morning. And I heard this, hey, dude, 5 o'clock in the morning. And I'm like, oh, I was in a cursing. That's just like, and that's what he's like. So don't ever stay with him, because that'll be what he does.
Yeah. It was good to see you, Pete. Are you leaving? What time are you coming back?
I've just finished the final phase of the stage show. I'm going to run it down. This is working at home. This is what I'm doing before I go on stage. I'm very much like Muhammad Ali in the sense that Muhammad Ali would sit backstage and he'd envision how the fight was going to go, and he'd imagine every single punch and every single line and every single punch that was counted. And more often than not, if you check this out, we could depict the actual round almost to the minute that the fight was going to go down every single time, just by spending his time envisioning the fight beforehand. So I normally spend about 3 minutes on the show going through every answer that could potentially be answered by the participant, covering every single out and contemplating what's going to happen, all the random things that could potentially happen, and I close them off before they do happen. And that's before every single
time. Hey Pete, can you stand a little bit more in front of the camera? Everybody's complaining that they can't hear you.
Do you want me to repeat?
Yeah, please.
So before Muhammad Ali had any fight, what he'd do, he'd sit off the back in the back room and he'd envision how the fight was going to go. Right down to what punch the opposition were going to throw at what time.
Right.
And he got so good at this that he could often work out what round the opposition were going to fall down in to the exact minute. So read up on this, it's genuinely true. So he used to envision every single punch, he used to envision every single count, every single punch. So I spend a lot of my time before the show going through everything over and over again, but thinking about every single answer that could be answered from a participant's mouth, every single random event that happened from the audience's perspective. And more often than not, I can often prompt things to happen from within the audience by leaving slight gaps open, envisioning them happening. So I'm going to now go to my meeting. My meeting is supposed to be at 11 o'clock. They're slightly late, 3 minutes late, which would have been different if it had been Monday. That's another story. And then I'm going to go envision how the show is going to go.
This is funny.
So I'm going to... I can't tell him the joke.
Hey, he can't tell you the joke. You just have to be here for it. It's funny. I didn't even think about it. Yeah.
Unfortunately, I caught just about every word, but it sounds like everybody else, nobody else did. It sounds like Peter was really muddied up his voice. Do you want to repeat what Peter said? Or do you want to just leave
Peter
that?
Said he's the Muhammad Ali of mentalism.
That's true. That is exactly what he said.
He said he will sucker punch you with his effects.
And that's actually true.
Yeah, have you seen I was just plugging your Win in Rome notes. I said I had like 5 pieces to my clip instantly into my stage show. It's brilliant. It's absolutely brilliant.
All right, so we've We've gotten pretty stretched out there. We should probably get back to some more questions before we let you go. I know you're kind of getting delirious at this point. So,
what are you talking about?
Totally lucid, man. All right.
Okay. Yeah, Jack Sparrow. All right. Sorry.
No, you're good. Scott Anderson. Okay, I'll wait. Scott Anderson asks, my question is, considering you're in Vegas, is there a magic act or show you're dying to see, and if so, who's the act and what makes the act appealing to you?
You know, I like all the circus. Always have. Looming Group's my favorite show. My favorite magic show is Copperfield. Every time I come to town, I try to see David. I love David's show. Blue Man Group is my favorite overall show in town, though. I think they have a wonderful show, and, you know, I'm a big fan of all the Cirque shows as well, like I said, but I'll probably go see David while I'm here.
I'm sorry, one more time?
I'll probably go see Copperfield while I'm here.
Copperfield? That's always a very theatrical show.
Yeah.
Let's see here. David, I believe this is Cleese. Asks, what do you use to start an audience and get them warmed up? You said that 30 seconds is so important to connect. How do you do it?
I actually start off with an effect called Sticky. And as you can see, it's not a pipe dream. I actually do the effect. I was doing it last night. And I haven't been to bed, obviously, so I'm about to get a shower in just a second, but it's what I usually open up with because it's a nice conversation piece, and it's a good way to connect with the audience because it has a nice little impact for them as well. I save like I'll do cold reading as well. Cold reading's a great way to open because you get to know the person on a personal level, and you build up like a trust with them. And then, you know, you can go into, you know, some mentalism effects. I generally, if I do a reading, though, I don't follow it by effects. I try to keep the two separate, if you know what I mean.
Right. Absolutely.
But, go ahead.
Oh, no. Please.
I try to keep the two separate. And, I mean, I like opening up with Sticky, and I'll do, like, metal bending towards the end or something like that. But this isn't a walk-around environment. Obviously, my show is more structured. But I just kind of wing it off the cuff because I have a lot of material that I can do impromptu. So I just kind of just wing it and throw it out there. I know that sounds bad, but...
No, absolutely. Actually, I mean, I'll be perfectly honest. I try to structure things as best I can. But I just kind of go, okay, this is where I want to start, and this is kind of where I want to end. So eventually I'm going to have to work back to this point.
Well, for example, if I'm at a table and I can tell that they're really receptive to, like, what I'm saying, but I'll do certain effects. But if I can tell they're not really following directions and they're not doing things, I won't go into stuff like psychological forces or hypnosis or stuff like that, you know?
Right.
I mean, I modify it if I'm doing walk around. I'll modify it depending on the audience.
Right. I mean, you kind of have to, especially when you're doing walk around. It's one thing when you're doing a stage show, you kind of, I mean, they're coming, everybody's come to see your show, whatever that may be, but definitely in walk around. Because my main form of performance is busking and bar hopping. So I'm seeing a new 3 to 8 people every 2 minutes. Or so.
Yeah.
And it's just constant, you know. It's nice because if you fail, you move on to the next person and be like, okay, you didn't like me, these people will. But it's still, I mean, in such an environment, you have to have enough to be able to custom suit kind of the different people you'll be meeting.
Here, I'm going to do this effect, but you're going to play the role of Stuart and Kristen, okay? That way we don't have to wait for the time to...
That's fine.
Okay. I want you to pretend you're Stuart first. You have a wallet, keys, and a coin, okay?
Wallet, keys, coin.
Now, I want you to just take these objects and I want you to think of them. They don't have to be in that particular order, but just think of them. And I want you to stop them. Don't tell me what it is. Okay. Now, if you were to change your mind, what would it be?
Coin.
Okay. Go ahead and put that in your pocket, okay? All right. Now, that leaves me and Christopher with two effects, or two items left. The wallet and the keys?
The wallet, yeah.
Now, in a moment, you're going to randomly select one for me. Choose an item.
Okay.
Which one?
The keys.
Okay, and that leaves me with the wallet.
Right.
Is that fair?
Yeah.
Yes? No? Do you want to trade, or is that fair?
No, that's fair. I mean,
now go ahead and read the prediction.
Where's... I have to go back to that. I had to go over to a different part. Oh, okay, so Stuart will put the coin in his pocket, Christopher will be holding the keys, and Morgan will be holding the wallet. So you got the wallet, I got the keys, and coins in the pocket. All right, yeah, no, that was exactly what it was.
This works a little bit quicker than waiting on the time delay.
Absolutely, yeah, no, I'm sorry about that.
I just kind of ran through it. I mean, obviously there's more presentation to it, but I ran through it because I know we're running late with questions.
Right. Well, you know, we're about four or five minutes off from the hour mark, and I know you're tired, so... So we'll try to get you off here soon. Just got a couple more questions. Glenn okay. Hampton, how do you feel when you see DC using your stuff?
DC?
Yeah, I'm not quite sure who DC is.
DC Comics? Is that what he's talking about?
I'm not sure. Glenn, if you want to add to that question... we can ask that, and that could be our last one. I had one earlier, and I can't remember who it's from, but it was your creative process in creating stuff that you're going to release.
You know what? My creative process is different. I'll come through spurts where I'll come up with, like, 15 or 20 effects in, like, a matter of a day or two, and then it'll be dry. I don't really have a creative process. I start off with a premise, and then I try to make that premise interesting, and it has to be thought-provoking to the audience, and then I'll backtrack the method. But the premise has to be there, you know, and it has to be a solid premise before I work on the method itself.
All right. Absolutely. Reverse engineering, that seems to be what most people do. This is how I want it to look. Okay, this is how I want it to feel. Okay, now let's figure out how we're going to do it.
Yeah, and it, as long as the premise is there, you know, the method will come.
Right. I mean, anything's within the realm of magic, really anything's possible. You just have to figure out how you're going to fake it, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
Well, I don't see Preston, or Glenn, rather. I don't see Glenn posting in. I know you got...
we're going to put Razor's Edge in sticky and a spun, or not spun, but sticky and a failsafe. I don't know how you want to give those out, but email me the addresses of the winner, and I won't be home for a few weeks, but I'll send it out as soon as I get back home.
All right, absolutely. And you said you were giving away what two items?
Razor's Edge.
Razor's Edge.
Failsafe and sticky.
Failsafe and sticky, so all three?
Yeah.
All right.
You can give them to different people, or you can give them to the same person. Just however you want to work that.
Okay, so I'll take Razor's Edge. all right, so what we'll do is we have Sticky, Razor's Edge, and Failsafe. So Sticky, Razor, Fail, those are the three words. You're going to be messaging my email. That's alex@believeinmagicplace.com. Send those over to me, and we'll do a drawing here in the next couple of days, and we will give those items away. So we'll raffle them off to your viewers. Yay, viewers.
Hey, thank you so much for having me. It's been great.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for being lucid with us today.
Oh, dude, I'm not lucid. I'm going back to bed. What are you talking about now?
All right. Well, have a good night.
Later, buddy.
Enjoy my fashion. We'll talk to you later.
All right, take care, buddy.
Bye.